Well, it started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
As they run to the top of the stretch, it's Starship Jubilee. Saez had that winning move off the turn, and he has the lead with Starship Jubilee. Tap It Today is back to second. Then in between horses, Magic Star is loose, but she's too late now as Starship Jubilee has fled the scene. It's Starship Jubilee into the final 16th, widening, and she's your Suwannee River Stakes winner. Starship Jubilee in front. Magic Star up.
What a thing of beauty that was yesterday with Starship Jubilee winning yet another graded stakes race on the Gulfstream Park sod. Certainly a claim of a lifetime. I think it's one of the best claims of all time. The only one you could even argue with is Lava Man, who made more money than Starship Jubilee. She may get the last laugh in the broodmare department, though, as far as ROI after the career. And hello, everyone. Track announcer Pete Aiello deputizing for Jason Blewett and Acacia Courtney. It's like the good old days, buddy. Yeah. Good to see you.
Back again. And that race yesterday was incredible. And as we were talking before we came on the air, not the favorite in that race.
That's so mind-boggling to me. I wish somebody had told me before I got here that I could get 6-5 on Starship Jubilee. I would have saved a little more of the arsenal for that.
Yeah, I mean, that was great. And what a great ride by Louis Saez. Kept everybody parked inside.
Total clinic. Yeah. Total clinic.
They just took him outside. Completely, very good race. So it was so impressive. Got to talk to Kevin, you know, the other day about just what that horse means to their family. And it's just been, like you said, claim for $16,000, a dream come true. And she's a sweetheart, small. She loves those peppermints. So she's like a pet to them who makes millions of dollars.
That's a great pet to have.
Exactly.
And speaking of pets, how about the B&B Cones getting the money yesterday at Tampa, beating Independence Hall? Congratulations to Luca Panici and the entire Heat team behind Sol Volante, one for the good team here. This horse has proven he's now a graded stakes winner on dirt, and I thought he was a freak when he broke his maiden on the turf, so he's a switch hitter, isn't he?
Yeah, he was just fantastic. And what a race, really nice ride by Luca Panici. Let that speed, just moved at the right time. What was the name of the horse?
Sam Davis, Independence Hall.
Independence Hall, you know, was the big favorite. You thought he was gone, like something like that. But nope, Luca caught him. So onward with them, owned by the Reeves now, I believe.
Yeah, they bought a big piece of him, and Patrick still trained. So congratulations, one for the home team yesterday at Tampa. 11 races in total here this afternoon. A nice guarantee in the Rainbows. Six of $750,000. It starts with race number 6 on the program. Of course, 2 pick 5 opportunities and 2 pick 4 opportunities as well. The sun is out, so the track is fast. The turf course is firm, and we kick off the program on the turf course. The turf course begins with a field of horses that have taken turns beating each other. You went with a horse who, at least in my view, is one of the key contenders here, and Algo Denal.
Yeah, this one is coming back to a mile after a 2-race win streak ended when she was finished in a dead heat for second. She was beaten in that. That was a good race. It was a 3-horse blanket. Finished going a mile in the 16th last time out. So I thought off that performance, 5-1 on the board, very early in the wagering right now. But I think this horse is the one to beat. Got to deal with that little bit of an outside. Side post.
Loses Jaramillo, which was a thing that I didn't like. And by the way, I'm only giving top picks out today as I was brought into the bullpen late in the game. So I didn't have time to do much warming up, and I didn't want to make a fool of myself. But I went with the 7 Fantastic Kingdom. You got to strike while the iron's hot, and I think that I have not derailed the Marcos Meneses train. I've been preaching about the guy, but he just keeps right on winning. And number 7 Fantastic Kingdom has his services here today. She was a good winner last time out. She takes a logical step forward. The waters do get a bit deeper, but you do get a good price with a guy that is the zone right now in Marcos Meneses.
Yeah, he's ruining his ROI, but he was bringing home those 30-1 shots all the time. Now he's won with the other day in his 3-race.
5-2.
5-2 he had, actually. 3-day win. So I used Sandrift in second, who was given some time off, talking about hot bonds for Safi Joseph Jr. Trio of In the Money finishes against similar quality. Crosstown at Gulfstream Park West. The barn, everybody knows, is real good with this type of layup. That's about 30%. Tyler Gaffleone back from Tampa to ride today.
Makes a ton of sense in this race here. Her best race is probably too much for these. The question is, will we get it off the freshening?
Yeah, and I close it out with Sassy Justice, but I'm going to go back. And let me tell you, I didn't have Marcos Meneses one of those times. You'd think I would be smart enough, not the favorite ones, of course, but the long shot ones. You'd think I would have jumped aboard before, like you said, it might be too late.
Well, I completely missed the Maideny one on the other day, the first timer for John Mazza, but I didn't let him beat me again. I had the St. Leonard horse pretty good because I thought, all right, Marcos is riding high now, and he rode beautifully on that. So I got $12, not $45 or whatever, but it was still money to roll in the bankroll. Speaking of rolling the bankroll, sorry.
No, what I was going to say, he's always been a good rider.
Yeah.
He's just getting some mounts and he's just in that zone. He's always been, you know, a good rider throughout the year. So.
Yeah, and it's great to see guys like that get some opportunity, and especially this time of year. That's, at least for my money, that's the one thing that's so surprising is he's doing so well with opportunities that he's getting in January and February. If those opportunities were coming in May or June, hey, you know, that's good. The herd thins out, but it's good to see that he's putting up some hefty win numbers against everybody's favorite riders, North American style, in Irad, Castellano, Leperu, all these guys that are coming in, and he's winning races despite having to ride against those guys.
Yeah, so, congratulations to him. On to the race number two.
The second race, the start of the 50-cent early pick four, two scratches in here, key scratch of the 5, Apache, also scratch number 7, Ike is great. So we're down to 5, you and I land on the same individual. Newcomer for Ralph Nix by the Big Beast, the Beast and I.
Yeah, he does an excellent job, Ralph Nix, with his first-time starters in maiden claiming ranks. He's over 27%. Big scratch in here. Gets Lasix, gets MSCL Jaramillo in the saddle. I use Feisty Bird in second in Frontier Mesa, but I think the race goes through that. Feisty Bird is listed as a gelding. He comes in from Churchill, so we'll see how he runs in the spot.
Well, he's got a lot of good company lines in his first two starts. The question is, will he be ready off the layoff? Usually the answer to that question when you're talking about Ian Wilkes horses is no. So we'll see how the betting takes place because he'll take a lot of money now with the scratches of the 5 and 7.
Yeah, and this Frontier Mesa listed as a gelding comes in. You know, he showed some speed in back here in November. Kelly Breen, Paco, he had a really good multiple win day yesterday at the fairgrounds. So maybe a horse like that. Like I said, a couple of scratches in that race, key scratches, because the other horse in here, Ike is whatever.
Ike is great because 5 and 7 are both out.
Yeah, Ike was my top pick. The 7 was my top pick in there.
Well, let's move to the third race. I need your top pick here in the worst way because this is the type of race that I am just completely and then I pick the same horse as you. These are not my type of races, folks. You know that I focus toward the bottom half of your racing cards. This is not that. This is a very good race, a 3-year-old allowance race on turf at 1/16. I hope this horse can carry both of us, but I guess he does figure summer to remember off a good run in the Kitten's Joy last time.
Yeah, stretching out to 1/16, followed that maiden special weight victory going 1 mile with that third place finish, as you mentioned, in the Kitten's Joy. But want to go back and show you the horse I have in second, Majestic Rose, last race from the quarter pole home. I thought this was impressive. You called it, so you know that.
Yeah, and this is one of those horses. I don't care how many times he runs, I'm going to try to call him something else because he looks exactly like Elusive Row. He has the same silks as Elusive Row. And if I'm being honest, I think there's another row in there. That every time that I look down at this horse's, I had looked down at this call when I called Majestic. I had to call it and look at the program every time I said his name, which is not usually how I do business. But he was a very good winner, and I think that was a pretty good race. Leading West came back to the last time out. But when you put in a kick like that and you're freshened up since, onward and upward, I think, right?
Yeah, I thought Julian did an excellent job getting him just up under the shadow of the wire. And earlier on from that race, he was 12th and last, so he was making his move on the turn. So we're going to put him on the ticket. And I used the 4, make a stand. Another from a Todd Pletcher in here that steps up to face winners. He led from start to finish. He beat those 75 maidens. You know, Javier Castellano in the saddle. Longer price of the uncoupled entry. We'll see how that plays out.
Well, you can also consider that if you're comparing the 1 to the 4 as far as delineation of the 1 and 8 being the top-tier contenders, the 4 who won last time was 8th behind Majestic Row first time out. So it might be 1-4 and then all the rest in race number 3. Let's go now to the fourth race of the afternoon. Ronnie, you're going to have to help me again. Very good maiden special weight event, 1 mile, the journey. These are some talented three-year-old fillies. We're going to have story time with Pete in a minute, but first I want to hear about number seven, Capiolani.
Well, Capiolani's wheeling back after the solid debut at this level in distance in which she shook off early traffic problems in that race. We'll go back and show you this performance. We're going to show you the head-on of this race where she gets that trouble, and then we're going to pick it up on a turn for home. She is the number four in there. She gets the old salami sandwich right there.
Boy,
ba-boom.
She sure did.
She did. So she comes back, and then we're going to pick it up as she runs. And she ran pretty darn good after that troubled beginning. So we'll see. I'll pick it up at the quarter pole, and there she is running. So I thought she ran a good race.
Now you've got my memory jogged here. Yeah. The horse that won this race was ultra impressive, New Day Dawning.
Right.
She never took a deep breath in the race. So for Capiolani to be second behind her, that is a very live maiden race she's coming out of. This horse who won, New Day Dawning, I expect to hear from her later on this summer.
Yeah, I mean, I put that one because of that performance on top of my ticket. I'll listen to your story, but first thing I want to share, here's a horse I might have missed. Acacia pulled a stat, or Jason, excuse me, pulled a stat on the three-horse token in here for Bill Mott, and it's a really good second. Second time out, sprinter route, maiden special weight on the dirt. Boy, he's good. He's 19%. He's in the money 49% of the time. 215 is the return investment. He had a horse yesterday come back in 14 days that was just monster yesterday. So just a stat. Now, I've had this horse further down on my ticket, but I think this stat is pretty telling.
Well, and that will segue nicely, but first of all, Token was favored in the career debut. When does Bill Mott go favored first time out? I mean, I don't pretend to know a whole lot about really good racing, but I know Bill Mott does not crank them first time out, and this horse chased a 44.5 mile last time out, and so did the horse. Now it's time for story time with Pete. I'm not much for pedigrees because, again, these races are too rich for my blood. However, it was great to see the number four Paid Up's mother in the program, Pay the Man. When I was working in Ohio, Cat Launch was the Mac Daddy on the male side. He would beat anything and everything in the Ohio bred ranks. However, Pay the Man was the absolute queen. We called her Superwoman. We had Superman and Superwoman. She made over $1 million, Ronnie, the hard way, Pay the Man. She went 6 furlongs to 1.5 miles, dirt, turf, you name it, she did it. She won races all over the place, even one down at Tampa. So nice to see the well-bred daughter of Oxbow and Paid Up, the four. This horse comes out of the same race as Token, strictly on the fact that I was a huge Pay the Man fan for the Pyrite stable. I picked Paid Up.
Well, you get good connections with Dale Romans and Luis Saez is just riding up a storm. So interesting in there. We're going to give that horse a second look. I actually had him fourth in there. And then I said, maybe I missed Token in the changes. So I was thinking like you a little bit in there.
Well, let's go to the fifth race now. $16,000 claimers at a 1 mile trip on turf. This is more my speed. And of course, Ronnie and I land on the same horse, number nine, till the end. You have to have thought the same thing as I did. I actually needed this horse bad last time, and this horse got a rough trip. It wasn't Torres' fault, don't get me wrong. He did everything he could to win the race. He just didn't have the racing luck that he needed to get there. Till the end was a much the best horse last time out.
Yeah, he's going to try and get back to the winner's circle today after following that victory at this level of distance. That was the one really good one, two starts back. Game second place finish. He's a hard-knocking eight-year-old, and he's just never been better. I mean, this guy just turned it around. He's been in great form.
Yeah, and I mean, the horse ran last time out again, he was down inside, and he was never going to beat Dalarna, but he didn't really get the trip that he wanted that day. And going into that race, he didn't look like he was a layover by any stretch of the imagination, so I was happy to see him hold his form. The question today will be, does Bold Daddy step up off of that victory last time out for Jason Service? I think that horse had to need that last race, and if he improves off of that, we're going to all be running for second money.
Yeah, Jason Service, I got that horse in second, a gelded son of a scat daddy. Cuts back to the mile. He's got a break from the outside. It doesn't seem to bother Iron when he's on the outside. He gets these horses to win. I actually was going to look up, and I didn't do it yesterday, how many horses from 11 out have won on the turf this year. It used to be none, and now it's been a lot better this year. So, Year of the Kit and the five horses, just my little bit of a story. Moved to the Pat Reynolds barn. He's not started many starters here. Pat Reynolds, I know him a long time. He moves horses up. Here's a horse you might want to put somewhere in your ticket. Maybe not to win it, but on the Trine Super. I don't know what he is on the morning line.
8-1.
8-1 on Victor LeBron in the saddle today.
One other comment about Bold Daddy. He's won four races in his life. He's never been good anywhere but Gulfstream Park. All four victories on the local sod. We'll see if he takes some play. I don't think you're getting 4-1 on him.
All right, take a break.
Yeah, time to take a break. Regroup. Well, more with Gulfstream Park today. Pete and Ron right after this.
It's the dawn of a new day in racing. All attention is on the safety of the horses from more professionals than ever before. Our eyes are on the prize to gallop past the old era towards a reinvention of our sport. Take your place with us now. This is it. The future of racing is off and running. It's all happening at each of our world-class venues. Our new vision for racing will drive us past the finishing line, heralding a new era for the sport. When betting, avoid the rush and allow FirstBet to give you a leg up. Our app uses real-time data to help you make your bets with confidence. Enjoy a new vision for post-race entertainment. From the oval to the stage, the after party, and beyond, we invite you to the future of racing. A first of its kind.
Back now with Gulfstream Park today. Track announcer Pete Aiello joined by ace handicapper extraordinaire Ron Nicoletti. Getting ready to preview the Rainbow Six sequence on a Sunday in South Florida. Guaranteed money today, $750,000 in guaranteed money if you can take down the jackpot pool. Of course, this is not an easy sequence, as it tends not to be this time of year. A nice maiden race to kick it off. Ronnie, 43-20?
43-20 for me, and it's amazing when I add it up at the end, even though I switch around, it always adds up to 43-20. Did go three deep in here with Prairie Wings in here, Fashion Babe, and Starlit Daydream, a horse will show its recent work. And this one from the Empire Racing Club, managed by the one and only Christina Bosanakis. It's a club that they have up where people get to be part of owning a horse. So running a little later on. My best bet is in race number 7. It's Liana Susquehanna, old Abbott and Costello routine I'll talk about later this afternoon. But I did use the 10 in there. Then I went Super Scat Daddy and Mutatif. How do you say that?
Mutatakif.
Mutatakif and Personal Time. My long shot today comes in race number 10 this afternoon, and it's La Australiana, 8-1 in the morning line. Back at a competitive level, was tilting win-wins a little bit there. Likes this distance of 5 starts, 2 wins, and 2/3.
Well, we both got some price horses we can talk about in the sequence. Your best bet comes in the 7th. That's where my upset possibility comes in. I think Blue Magic's the horse to beat in here, and that race as well. Here in race number 6 today, I must have sent in the wrong number. I was a Sconset fan on top, but I don't mind American Model. This is not my type of speed. This is where I need help, not only from you, from anybody on Twitter. Maidens of the special weight caliber, these are really nice 3-year-old fillies. We've seen some really good ones so far this winter. I think we have a chance to see some really good ones again here. With Starlit Daydream, Sconset, and Prairie Wings. They look like three talented debut runners.
Well, Fashion Babe is turning back to 6.5 at the finish. The second was the odds-on choice going 7/8. It's Jason Servitz. It's Irad. Beaten favorite in 4 consecutive races, so you got to be careful. I told you we're going to show you weight. A work on Starlit Daydream. They like this horse this afternoon for whatever that's worth, you know that. And we're going to pick it up here and you'll see the work. And it's just Starlit Daydream, as I mentioned, Empire Racing Club, string of solid workouts, this being one of them back on February 2nd. So comes into the race and I think off this performance seemed to be looking around a little bit there, getting ready to run.
Well, it seems to me like Todd Pletcher's first-time starters and Todd Pletcher horses in general, they're conditioned to have to be ridden to get high gear. I've talked to Edgar Zayas about this a lot of times, and he agrees with me. You have to keep after him a little bit. So John Velasquez knows that. He's won umpteen thousand races in his career and probably a few thousand for Todd Pletcher. Maybe not that many, a couple hundred anyway. But Starlit Daydream, she... When you're looking for, at least for me, right. And I'm the host today, not the handicapper, yeah. But Fashion Babe is an exposed type animal.
Right,
she's been heavily favored in all of her races. We know how fast she is. I just have to take it on faith that the McLaughlin horse or the Pletcher horse or the Colebrook horse just by default are faster than the 7. And if we can get a better price on them, let's give it a try.
And that's why I did go 3 deep in there in the first leg of the Rainbow Six.
Well, let's go to the 7th race. This is my 5-5. Everybody expects... At least we haven't done this show maybe in 2 years with me and you doing it together. But everyone who watches us comes to expect a little controversy. I expect some controversy here because I don't know what trip you think Liana Susquehanna is going to get where she's going to be the horse to beat here.
Well, she's back in the from the layoff, back in the claiming ranks after following a $20,000 victory, going 5.5 furlongs, comes back with a third place finish in the 5 furlongs, safely kept up at Monmouth. Jason Service sweetens the deal. Iran Ortiz Jr. in the saddle today. Bam, jumps off the page at you.
Well, there is a key scratch here. I should maybe temper my enthusiasm a little bit. Number 4, my Sarasota Star, who figured to be a huge part of the pace scenario, is withdrawn. That'll help Dealer's Girl in our next roll. Are you thinking the 3, like, pockets up behind those 2 speed horses and then gets first run on Blue Magic and horses like Taylor's in Orbit?
Yes, and that's exactly what IRED's been doing the whole meet. So Blue Magic, I know you have on top of your ticket, isn't going to the Mike Maker barn.
Yeah, but she's dependent on the pace, so she'll need to trip out and come rolling. Another horse in my upset possibility of the day, it's not on your screen, so write it down. I'm getting ready to tell you. I think the 11, Taylor's in Orbit, will outrun her odds. If the pace is as quick, as contentious as I think it will be, it'll be something that Taylor's in Orbit will enjoy. She's probably not up to snuff as far as beating horses like the 3 and 10, but she'll be a big number with Luca Panici fresh off a victory yesterday. She will outrun her odds. Include her on your tries and supers at a big number.
You just want to say, Luca Panici.
Well, everybody loves it. They yell it with me now. I can hear. By the way, if you're on track with me and you hear Luis Saez or Luca Panici or anything like that that you know I'm getting ready to say, and you say it with me, I definitely hear it. I hear it, and it actually makes me laugh every time.
Good for that. All right. I'm ready for the next race.
Ready for the next race? All right. We'll go to the 8th race now. Allowance horses on turf, A other than variety, 1 mile the trip, and a pretty star-studded cast in here as well. Lots of different ways to go. You went with Super Scat Daddy on top. I guess that makes sense. Muta Taki figures to go favorite off the long layoff for Chad Brown.
Absolutely. But Super Scat Daddy's turning back to a mile, returned from about a 10-month layoff to prompt the pace before weakening to finish 6th. That was in the $150,000 Sunshine Millions turf. Mark Cassie, Tyler Gaffleon named to ride. Chad Brown, you know, is going to take all the money. He's good with this type of layoff, 29%. And I also used a 5 personal time in there, who I thought would run, who's going back to the turf today. Following that maiden victory, was up at Keeneland, comes back, runs 3rd on the Keeneland main track. It's a Son of Malibu Moon, and our buddy Edgar Zayas in the saddle.
Well, personal times run 1 race on grass, and it was a winning effort, 1-for-1 on the Gulfstream Park sod. Can't argue with anybody who likes that horse. Interesting notation for me is Super Scat Daddy. It's handicapping 101. Second start off the shelf, should be a good one. This horse on buyers fired a big shot off the layoff, was nowhere, but ran an 89 figure. So either that race came back too fast, or Super Scat Daddy's in for a very nice drop in class today.
Yeah, I just thought off that performance that, and I like to turn back and distance that. I put her on top. But once again, I went a couple deep in there when I was putting my Rainbow Six ticket together.
Well, let's go now to the 9th race of the afternoon. The first leg of the late pick 3, Florida bred allowance horses at a 7-furlong trip. A scratch in here of number 1 captured the genie, a fairly significant scratch as she was 7-2 in the program. Morning line favorite is Let's Be Honest off a 2nd place run last time out. I went in a different direction. However, you landed on Let's Be Honest.
Yeah, this one scratching at the 7/8 of a mile today after returning from that freshening, finished 2nd against the same level. Larry Pilotti, Javier Castellano in the saddle today. I did have the 1 on top of my ticket, so I just moved this one up there and added the 4 Mandamus, who I find interesting in this spot.
Why is that?
Well, I'll tell you why. He was 2nd in the Juvenile Filly Sprint at Gulfstream Park West. Drops to the 16 level after dueling for the lead and weakening in a local return. That's against 75 optional claimers, Jorge Navarro, Jose Ortiz. I just thought with the scratch of the 1 in here, this horse had a shot, so I added this one to my ticket.
Well, here's the case that I can make for you on Mandamus. She was in a perfect position turning for home last time, and they called on her, and she had this much.
Yeah.
Now, that's the excuse, because she can't be that bad. We know how good she is. As you already said, she was 2nd to CC Valentina, and she was actually 3-for-3 in the top 2 going into that race, so that race is such an aberration, I think you can toss it out and just take it on faith that Navarro will have her better today than he did last time out. That being said, I don't see much speed in here. And I know that Sweet Mia didn't get a very good figure for her maiden victory, but I like the way she did it. She had something in the tank. She's drawn out wide. If, in fact, the speed doesn't go, Irad can be aggressive on her. It is interesting that he opts for Sweet Mia over Mandamus. Maybe there wasn't an excuse, or maybe he just thought Sweet Mia's maiden victory was as good as I did.
Yeah, I mean, almost won that race by 5 lengths, and you get an IRA, and that is going to be the speed in there. If they choose to put this one on the point, I think Sweet Me has a shot in there. So let's be honest, I put that one on top.
She'll need some pace ahead of her. We'll see how it goes. I like your logic with Mandamus, and I'm sure I'll like your logic with La Australiana in here, because I didn't like the favorites as we moved into the 10th race, a two other than allowance race on the turf. Just a small shout-out since I have the floor to do it. Dave Bailey has been doing an amazing job since coming back to Gulfstream Park as our racing secretary. He's carting races in categories that we haven't seen for a long time, such as this two other than on the turf, a great field here, and your long shot of the day.
Yeah, La Australiana, 8-1, is back at a competitive level, as I mentioned a little earlier. Couple of ambitious outings against graded stakes competition. Juan Avila does an excellent job. He's got MSCL Jaramillo handling to turn back. This is this horse's best distance. 5 starts, 2 wins, 2/3. This is a good spot. I'm hoping I get 8-1 on this one.
And you very well may, because it's not like you have a huge amount of good form to go on, and this is a tough enough race that even though she's coming out of stakes races, people are not going to be, major drop, because there's some quality horses in here. For my money, Miss Munnings is a bet against, and it looks like you agree. Just off the fact that she hasn't been seen since June, I know she likes this turf course, and I know she's been in good form, but you got to think she's going to need one, and against a quality group of fillies and mares like this, you're not going to have the luxury of getting to run an okay race against this caliber off the shelf, at least for me.
Yeah, I mean, I put it further down for all the reasons you might. But now she's 8-9 in the money on this course, Miss Munnings, so she loves it here. We've seen a horse win the stake yesterday that proved there is such thing as a horse for course angle here. I had this horse back in third and second. I put Ubulant, who will make it try and make it 2 in a row after breaking from the outside, rocketing to the lead in that race, and winning by 3 punts. Let's go show you that race.
It was a very, very good race. Enterprising ride from Nick Juarez, who does not get the return call today. Jose Ortiz plies his hand on the Mike Matz trainee. The question I had coming into this race, and I don't know the answer, is we don't haven't been running like a regular diet of two other thans on the turf. So how much tougher is a other than to a two other than? And to my money, I think it's got to be a pretty significant step up. That being said, Ebullient stepped up last time out, and her two victories in her career were both over the Gulfstream side.
Yeah, I mean, she was very impressive. And she just went right to the lead. There was no ifs, ands, or buts about it in there. I think it's a good race. And like you said, I tried to get a little bit of a price. And this is the type of people always ask me about my long shots. This is where you try and find something that, you know, that might sneak, you know,
sneak by the Raven. That was what I went with here on 6 cash out. This horse has been laid up, as so many of the key contenders have in this race. She's been freshened up since a try against graded stakes horses last time out. Rusty Arnold can get one ready, and for my money, she's fired well fresh in the past. Chris Landeros is a lot better rider than his racing statistics show at Gulfstream Park. And this horse, to me, I think she's a sneaky also. I'm trying to do the same thing as you, just with a different horse.
This is the best betting race on the card for that exact reasons we were both, you know, mentioning. So if whether it's the 6, the 5, I just think the favorites, you know, they're okay, but not great. So you try and find a little bit of a spot there, knock some of those people out of the Rainbow Six. Or
I agree completely. So if you're a favorite player, make sure you play race number 10, because we have officially locked in the two favorites now.
There's no way the favorite could lose.
Let's go to the 11th race now. The 11th race, I don't think there'll be a strong favorite in here. Maidens on turf at 1/16. This is a $16,000 race, and I don't know about you. This might be one of the saltiest $16,000 races I've ever seen. Hail Michigan on a huge class drop. Duelist is dropping in class. The horse that we both like in Traffic Trouble is taking a huge class drop. And the 8, looking at Roses, who we both picked on top, taking a huge class drop. This is a 16 maiden, but a 32 caliber race.
Yeah, you know, looking for it, she'll be looking for the 8, looking at Roses, will be looking to get to the trip to the winner's circle. And she drops, she removes the blinkers, she faced tougher up in New York. But Danny Gargan's horses have all run exceptionally well. No matter where he puts them, they just fire. So that was my thought process.
Mine
there.
Too.
Traffic Trouble I had in second, who's dropping into the 16, and Hail Michigan has its claiming tag sliced in half for Barkley Tech. So as you said, It's a 32,000. It says 16, but it's at least a 32,000 once you start reading through the past performance.
And the thing that's kind of an anomaly about this race is usually the 16 maidens may have one of these major class drops. All three, the 6, 7, and 8, all taking significant drops in class. I'm with you on the Gargan horse. Interestingly enough, Traffic Trouble was in earlier this week and scratched off the also eligible list. And Castellano Javi was in the jock's room when I was in there talking about how this horse has no speed, that he'll just have to tuck and roll. I think that'll be the plan with Traffic Trouble today. So hopefully no Traffic Trouble.
No Traffic Trouble, and he'll be back. And how could you go wrong with Javier in the saddle?
Hall of Famer for sure, and he was a longtime South Florida invader, or a South Florida native, as you well know, before he moved on to bigger and better things. Yeah. Bigger and better things to come here today with a 28 minutes to first race post time, 12:35 the start today. Track is fast, the turf is firm, program changes in a moment. For Ron, I'm Pete. Good luck today.